Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Assalamu alaikum, everyone. Welcome to all of you, our honored guests, especially those of you who have come from Montreal. Barakallahu feekum. Thank you so much for making the journey. My name is Shahnaz Karim, and I'm a part of Sanad Collective, your hosts for tonight. So I'm going to say a few words just about who we are as Sanad Collective. Who is Sanad Collective? The word sanad in Arabic means link, and it means support. So the mission of Sanad Collective is to bring us all together and also to link us to our spiritual heritage, the world heritage of all human beings, through meeting and connecting to our elders like Sheikha Maryam and other elders who are teachers and guides on the journey of life. As you know, the word collective means coming together, and it's a group of individuals who come together to become something larger and something greater than just the sum of the parts. So whoever comes forward is part of the collective, and that's a message that we want to share with you. We're not just an organization, although we have aspects and we have a nonprofit status and so on, but we're a collective in the sense that everyone is welcome to be part of what we do and who we are. And everyone has something to share and everyone has something to contribute. So we invite you to be part of that with us. And of course, by just being here, you're already being part of that. So welcome and thank you. As a collective, we have three basic activities that we are involved in. And those are seeking knowledge and wisdom together in fellowship, nurturing the soul, and then sharing compassion. And that sharing of compassion is the fruit of those other activities, seeking knowledge, seeking wisdom, and then also taking care of our spiritual essence. We hold gatherings of meditation and fellowship each weekend, both in Montreal and in Ottawa, and we welcome you to be part of that. And our resident scholar, Sheikh Hamdi bin Isa, also teaches weekly classes. So on Friday nights, for example, we usually have a class called Walking on the Shore of the Divine. Again, it's about this journey to the divine. And there's a lot of reflection on Prophet Muhammad as a teacher and a guide and what he shared of wisdom on that journey. So we have, as a collective, we have a milestone that's coming up. God willing, we hope to establish a permanent space that can host and house these sorts of activities, and that can be a place where people can come in from all walks of life and find safety and find access to the sacred and different ways of connecting with the divine on their own authentic terms and with sisterhood and brotherhood. And we feel that that's an important step that we need to take as a community to really open our doors to everyone and engage. So if you want to know more about that project, we invite you to come and speak to us after the event, and you can have more information at the tables outside so that you can share in the barakah of this project, inshallah. It's going to be a beautiful place, God willing, where everyone can come and bloom. Now I'd like to just take a moment before moving into the program. I'd like to ask Sidi Henrik, who is a part of Sanad Collective, to recite something for us.
Alaykum salam.
جزاك الله خيرا. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته.
عليكم السلام ورحمة الله
وبركاته. O you who've gone on pilgrimage, where are you? Where, oh where? Here, here is the beloved. O come now, come, O come. Your friend, he is your neighbor. He is next to your wall. You, erring in the desert, what air of love is this? If you'd see the beloved's form without any form. You are the house, the master. You are the Kaaba, you. Where is a bunch of roses if you would be this garden? Where one soul pearly essence when you're the sea of God? That's true. And yet your troubles may turn to treasures rich. How sad that you veiled yourself, the treasure that is yours. Come, come, whoever you are, wanderer, worshiper, lover of leaving, it doesn't matter. Ours is not a caravan of despair. Even if you've broken your vows 1,000 times, come, come, come. These two poems were by Mevlana Jalaluddin Rumi. May Allah be pleased with him and raise his station. Thank you.
Thank you.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum alaikum. Tonight, as you can see, thank God, alhamdulillah, we have with us a very, very special guest, friend, and elder. Sheikha Maryam is a spiritual traveler, a guide, and someone who has permission to teach the ways of the path to God. In addition to this evening's talk, inshallah, Sheikha Maryam will be staying with us over this weekend, and we have 2 day-long retreats coming up. I really encourage you to find out more about that and to reserve a place to be with us again, which you can do at the front tables. Tonight, Sheikha Maryam will be speaking about the journey to peace. Just to give you an idea of how the timings will work, Sheikha Maryam will speak for about 50 minutes or so, and then we'll be opening the floor to question and answer, and by about 8:30, we'll be closing the evening, inshallah. Allah yabarak fikum. Thank you so much for joining us, Sheikha Maryam.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين. السلام عليكم wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. Our hearts are joined here for a very holy and divine, blessed purpose which transcends our comprehension. Beloved Shanaz heard a radio program that was made along with Sheikh Hamdi in California, called Soul of Islam. And I made that interview without knowing. I've never heard the interview. I don't know what is in it, but our intention was, in sending out the message, that we would meet our beloved companions on the journey across the face of the earth. The first response that came to us was from Ottawa, from every one of you. And now that I sit here with chills from head to toe, I see mission accomplished. Mission accomplished. Simply in assembling fi sabilillah, assembling for the sake of God, embracing all lives as our own, cherishing one another for the sake of God, listening with compassionate ears, what's called compassionate listening. Even when we don't speak, we can listen. By sitting here with you, I hear. I'm hearing you. I'm hearing you with my heart. And everyone that I met here, I felt that I had been with in the world of souls. No one is like a new person. Everyone is someone so deeply connected with my journey that I can only say, this is not a caravan of despair. This is a caravan of joy, of bliss, of hope, of that we may be guided clearly, step by step. And it's not individual. We're not isolated. And no one should feel isolated in this journey. That is why beloved Rumi, Maulana Rumi, tells us that it's a caravan of dreams, a caravan of intentions, in which everyone is going together who cares to make this journey. So we want to end the idea that people are suffering from unhealed traumas because they feel alone on the journey. And that as the prophets, peace and blessings be upon every one of them, came to earth with infinite blessings to bestow upon humanity, how amazing is it that we are the recipients of these blessings and the givers of the wonderful news, transmitters of the wonderful news. What did our prophets come to bring us? What did our holy prophet Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, come but to bring mercy to who? All the worlds, all the beings, all the living beings. So that is what this organization is clearly devoted to. And the way in which they heard that interview made them understand that that's what we're devoted to. And in fact, we are all devoted. We are all devotees of this process of enlightenment, of the earth person by person, and then in twos and threes. My son Isa received his master's degree in Peace and Conflict Resolution International, Peace and Conflict Resolution, along with trauma healing. So when we assemble like this, I believe this is what the course is all about. The course is to notice. We were sitting after a show in a public place in Philadelphia, and we saw someone walking down the steps on crutches. Well, how can you walk down steps on crutches, really, without maybe falling? So we just went to her and said, let us take you where you're going. And he helped her down the steps, and then we took her in the cart to her home. She was going to the bus. How could she get into the bus and come out of the bus? So the process of being truly in the state of Islam is that the compassion is flowing like a stream through our hearts. We do not look at someone who doesn't understand things exactly the same way that we do and cut off their heads because they haven't heard the word yet. You have to give the word, share the wonderful news, and inspire others to see what you have seen. Just as some of us may have been born in this path of knowledge and may not have even realized what their heritage was. Some of us were walking on the journey guided from one oasis to another until the vision became absolutely clear. What Islam is, what the root of the word Islam is, peace. So when we talk about the journey to peace, we have to understand what Islam is. And we have to transform the paradigm prevailing in the world, which is almost contradictory to that. The word is being passed around that is total kufr. It's totally covering up this beautiful peace. And if the peace is going to manifest, it has to come through people like us. We can't say, what is the matter with the Muslims? Who are the Muslims? Who are we? And each one of us, you know, we were at your home, at the home where we were staying, and so we were expressing these feelings, and at a certain moment, the call to prayer started coming on all sides. It came from all parts of the city, of the house, of the realms. I don't know. Where were all those call to prayers coming from? Personally, I don't know. And then the rain came pouring down. All of this is confirmation. Confirmation that Islam is peace, and that we are the bearers of this peace. Everyone who has received one atom of grace is now the one who is carrying that atom, and it will increase as you go on this journey. So I'm going to talk about the journey towards this awakening, and it's full of awakening. It's the goal is happening as we walk. The journey is going somewhere, but it's happening every step of the way. So our goal is to become truly conscious travelers and being aware of the signs of God as they manifest every moment. And I want you to be aware, as we discuss this, of the sacred journey that you yourself have been on. Because many of those things which happened in our earliest days, the babies know and the adults have forgotten. And we need to go back in our journals, scroll back in the journal to remember what Allah has revealed to you throughout your entire life. And treasure it. Make a sacred repository. Don't let those treasures sit on the wayside while you worry about the world and its problems. You have to collect these treasures in a repository and lay them on the table. It's called a maida. Lay out the treasures on the table and invite others to come and partake. You don't say, this is not a Muslim, they cannot come in. The door is open and the treasures are there. And one by one, all the seekers of joy and peace and love will come and find this bounty awaiting us. It's still awaiting us. We've learned it and we have to learn it again. How many times have we heard the words and we have to say them again? Because at each station of the journey, you're in another level or maqam. So you say the surah again and you understand it so differently. And when you understand it deeper and more marvelously, then you're going to find someone like that girl who needs to be helped. They might need a ride. They might need a word of mercy. They might need guidance, and everyone does. Everyone does. We're not exclusivists. We are here to share the wealth, the bounty. And I want to explain how I got here, because we all are, you know, recipients of grace that is unfathomable. And no one is planning this but Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the master of this plan. And when I tell you what happened, you'll see how clear it was in this case. I was in South Carolina with Sheikh Harun, my Sheikh who endowed me with grace and guidance and blessings on the journey. And we've been traveling basically together forever. And as time went on, I came to understand that every drop of grace that has been bestowed upon me has to be embraced by me and then shared. So I have come to embrace, I've been going back over the journey of my life and understanding what each sheikh, what each graceful being that I encountered on the path imparted. And now we have to accept it all and transmit it. So at that moment in South Carolina, I was in a room in his office with the copy of my book, Journey Through 10,000 Veils, The Alchemy of Transformation on the Sufi Path. And we were intending and entering into the mystery of making it into a movie. For what purpose? Because the light of Islam needs to manifest on the screens of the world. When we look at the TV screens, they're covered with darkness. And nothing is transmitted but fear and hopelessness. And there's no light. Now, each and every one of us has been the recipient of boundless miracles of light, and they need to be manifested possibly in the form of film or in the form of sharing words, but they need to come out, and that's why we made the interview that led us to you. So we were in the room praying, you know, deeply for the manifestation of grace. And I then left with a few friends on the journey, and we went on the journey back home, maybe 12 hours. It was maybe 1:30 in the morning. I went into the computer and saw the name of someone who is Imam Taha Hamid, and he is has a radio, a TV program called Islam in the West. So I just sat down and wrote him a letter on the internet. Now we understand that the internet is, as everything is, the tool of God. It can be used for the very opposite purpose, and we know that. But why should it not be used to send the message of light across the worlds? And all those people who are turning on the internet should get this message, should at least be, you know, it's easier now. How many more people can hear about it now than just one person walking in a desert, right? So this is a system that may really be useful. And it was. So I sent him a letter that said, I was guided to you, and I have had very holy experiences in Afghanistan. And I sent him three paragraphs from the book, and within about a few hours, he sent me back a response and said, please come to our community. We need you to come. Come in 2 weeks, and we will have a gathering of 400 to 500 people, and we need you to speak to us. This is a Muslim man from a traditional background who is a spokesperson for Islam in the East and the West, who is guiding people to Mecca on every Hajj, who understood that for some reason it was necessary for a woman of Islam to come and address the community. And that in itself is a sign. This is not a sexist message at all. It's that everyone is welcome to proclaim this beautiful message. And this is how we will end these divisions and barriers and limitations, false limitations. So I went there, and it was marvelous, like this. The people were just like this, open, and hearts so open, children and, you know, fathers, mothers, children in a large assembly. And so I gave a talk there, and about that I was speaking to Palestinians and Afghanis and Moroccans and people, young people who may never have seen what I saw in their countries. In other words, I went to those countries to behold the beauty and grace that existed there before the dawn of the falling of the hammer of imperialism upon it. And I'm a witness to that, and will bear witness to that, you know, to bring to life the living heritage that exists in every living being, whether you were born there or you were not. Because when I went there, I was overwhelmed by the heritage that descended upon me. It fell down like rain of grace upon me. In every Muslim country where I went, and even in other countries, I was on trains going through India, and I heard the sounds of the zikr going on in those countries. And it was prayer. So this was a journey of prayer in which the prayers of all humanity were entering my heart. And so I told the story about what I had experienced to the people who may not have seen it, and they saw it. And the whole room was filled with light. And then he told me about others. You know, he said, now I have other people that I've been with in Los Angeles. And so he connected me to those people. And later on, I was at a conference there and met another wonderful assembly of people. And it kept going on, heart to heart, you know, soul to soul, and until we made that radio program called Soul of Islam. And none of it was planned. In other words, if I had written out an itinerary for my life story, it would not include any of this because I didn't know. I had no idea. But Allah knew everything. Allah had inscribed this in the records, in the Lahu Mahfuz. This is what I want to communicate or share from my heart with each and everyone, is that it's all written in the Lahu Mahfuz. What every step that you will take towards the divine has decreed for you and us ultimately. So that was the, you know, how then the soul of Islam, we said as we were making the recording, I came to town and my friend, my beloved friend, who is Afghani, who really intended this so strongly, Mahsuda, said, you have to go now and make this interview. And I was very tired, but I couldn't say no. So we went to the place, the studio, and it's a zawiya, beautiful zawiya in Orange County. And we made that interview, and our intention was clearly stated between us, may this reach the souls who are waiting to join with us in this journey. And that was you. So the sound, if it never reaches one more congregation, it was made alone for this purpose. And we must do everything like that. We don't know the end. We don't even know the beginning. We don't know where we are going. Allah knows everything. And He knows that we were destined. You see, if I looked in a phone book, I could never have found you. If I looked online, well, maybe. But it didn't happen that way. Even the sheikhs that I met, I could not have found them. Except that Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala, had decreed the journey be like this. So, it was. I wrote a book about it simply to be able to proclaim these mysteries one by one that are signs of God. These are the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And every one of us is the benefactor of these messages. But sometimes the messages that have come to us have become covered up by kufr in one form or another. Fear or attachment or worldly, you know, goals. You think you want something else and you are pursuing it and you don't realize you already have what you need. That everything you have Allah has given you and He will continue to do so. So where are we looking? Elsewhere. When we're looking elsewhere, we're covering up the transmission that is taking place right now, that He has for us now. And I'm going to read a little bit about this. And as we go, it's about what I'm really, my intention for this assembly today, tomorrow, and the next day, and maybe for years to come, is that as we sit together in this circle of remembrance, circle of love, unbroken circle, all welcoming to all, we are absorbing the messages that are descending upon us from our past, our present, and our future, that our beloved best of friends, our dearest of companions, is embracing us now and always. And as we were sitting in the room earlier, the rain was just pouring down upon us as it is here. So the rain takes different forms. You know, it waters the earth and it waters the heart and soul. So what is the rain? And where is the rain that waters our heart and soul? It's in our ummah. It's in our community. It's in our sharing of knowledge. And that is what the organization is dedicated to. And it will continue, because nothing is better on the face of the earth. No gathering. Wherever the people are gathered to watch a ball game or to go to a bar or to go anywhere and do anything else, they won't get what a gathering like this is here for, to receive and will receive. So our intention, our dua, is that we realize the power of dua. We realize that there is no dua that is separated from the one who hears the prayer. The dua is, he says to us, you walk one step to me, I will come 100,000 steps to you. When you make one prayer, that prayer is answered in so many ways, in so many means. So why turn in any other direction to find the answer to your life dilemmas? And that's what we're here to remind each other of. And even whether it's one-to-one, or we're working in an auditorium like this, or we're out in country with the horses tomorrow, wherever we go, and everyone is welcome in our home in Philadelphia, and we could go to South Carolina, we could go to Los Angeles and to Dallas, Texas, and just join with the people everywhere. And once we put out these messages, more and more people will say, we're here, we're here, we're signing on, and we've already signed on. You know, everyone is in their different areas, and the media is keeping people separated by these messages of fear, and they say, don't travel. You better not get on that plane, you know, because they don't want the assembly to take place. You know, the assembly is the power that will answer these fears. The more that we stand together, the more we join together, the more we bow down together, you know, we are the people of who will be uplifted and empowered to represent the message of truth in our time. So I'm going to read a little bit of this, but I think before that I'm going to read from my Sheikh Bawa Mohayadin about Islam and world peace, because this theme is so relevant. And if we can be the messengers of this, the world will be transformed. And it is, and it is. It's being transformed. And it must start with ourselves. It's Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Islam does not mean killing or attacking others. When such a thing happens, Islam is being harmed itself. To embrace others with love and to dispel their hunger, disease, poverty, and difficulties is Islam. To speak to someone from within the embrace of unity is Islam. To be together, to eat together, to live as one life in a state of affection is Islam. That is love, God's love, and Islam is the affection shown through that love. Islam is the compassion shown by acting with Allah's 3,000 gracious qualities. Islam is establishing the praise of Allah and establishing the qualities of sabur, shukur, tawakkul, and alhamdulillah. Islam is Allahu Akbar, the one Allah is most great. One who is Islam will practice these good qualities and continually beg of Allah, Astaghfirullah al-Azim, O Allah, forgive all our faults and correct us. That is what is meant to be a mu'min, to be in Islam. To become one is Islam. Just as five fingers come together to form one hand, to be one with everyone is Islam. There is only one group in Islam, the group which loves Allah, the group of Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. There are 73 different groups of human beings, but of those, Islam is the one that has faith in Allah without the slightest doubt or wavering. There is only one race for a Muslim. There is no black, white, or yellow. There is no fighting and no division. How can we divide Islam and fight over it? How can we listen to people who goad us into fighting by complaining, those men are different from us? The nature of true Islam is to bring together what has been divided. Once we were separate and divided and scattered in many different directions, but the Kalima and Islam brought us together to worship the one God and embrace each other's heart, heart to heart. We must be one. We must not create divisions by talk of different people, different positions, or different status. There are no divisions within Islam. Once someone has said the Ashadu Kalima, there is only one way to describe him, a child of Islam, nothing else. Earlier he might have been different, but now he is a Muslim. He might have been in another religion before, but now he is in Islam. True Islam is unity. There are no titles and no differences. There is only one great title, Ya Allah, Ya Mawla. We may call men of wisdom by title of Mawla, and we may even call those who have converted to Islam Mawla Islam, but Allah alone is Mawla, the Lord, the Master in Islam. We have to become slaves to Him alone, servants to Him alone. He is the only one worthy of worship. We must not create divisions in Islam, calling some high and others low. There's no such thing in the Kalima. Can we recite the Kalima and then separate Muslims into different categories, saying some are high and some are low? No, we cannot say that. A tree may have many branches, but the flowers and the fruits on that tree are all the same. Is that not so? When does it matter if a fruit is on a lower branch or a higher branch? Their seeds are the same. We cannot show favoritism in Islam. We are all the creations of Allah, the children of Adam, alayhi salatu salam, the tribe of Abraham, alayhi salatu salam, the followers of Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He sends food to all and protects us all. Tomorrow, we will all be questioned, no matter who we were or what position we held. On the day of Qiyamah, questioning, judgment will be given for the good and evil of each of us, that each of us has gathered. Before that time, we cannot tell if someone is good or bad, or high or low in status. We are all Adam's children, all fruits from the same tree. Of course, there is one small difference. Some fruits may be fully ripe and very tasty, and some may be in the process of ripening. And some may still be hard as a rock, but we cannot hurry the unripe fruits by beating them. Each one will ripen in its own time, according to how much sun it receives and whether the wind blows on it from a southerly or northerly direction. Similarly, if we want to help the children of Adam, alayhi salatu salam, to ripen, we can only do so by showering them with good qualities, not by beating them. We have to ripen them and make them peaceful with the kind of loving affection that regards other lives as our own. We have been told, love your neighbor as you love yourself. We have not been told to beat our neighbors, to kill them, or to cut them up. That will not ripen them. Only if a man's heart is melting with love can he reach a state of acceptance. His heart has to be right. When we show someone love, compassion, trust, and friendship, he will melt in our embrace. Affection evokes affection. Let us embrace our neighbors as the Rasul, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, has taught us and as he has shown us in his example. Let us share with them the things, the treasures that Allah has given us. To live together in unity with all groups is the proof that we are the children of Adam, alayhi salatu salam. Love your neighbor as yourself. Do not take his land and kill him. So now our message is to follow the sunnah of our beloved Rasul, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, to show what real diplomacy is. Diplomacy that comes from existing in the infinite wealth of Allah's mercy. What does it mean to be mercy for all the worlds? What does it mean that He is mercy for all the worlds? This is a message that needs to be not only spoken, proclaimed, and manifested, but literally shared with humanity. And that is why we are all gathered together here. We're gathered together so that each living being can be empowered to know the truth that we know, to bear witness in our existence in this life to the truths that have rained down upon us, that are hidden from a lot of the world. So when people are speaking in the name of Islam and doing the absolute opposite of this, manifesting the opposite of mercy, we need to speak up and sing as a choir of grace, inspired by angels with us singing, the angels with us singing these truths of Allah's mercy for the world, that Allah is mercy for the world, that the prophets completed in the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came not but to bring mercy. They didn't come to bring terror, fear, and division and conflict. They came to bring Furqan, which discerns truth from falsehood, light from darkness. And as we see the light emerging from the darkness, we need to proclaim it and let it shine. Let it shine. And so this takes place in our neighborhoods. It takes place in the bank. It takes place in the supermarket. As I very deeply know, because I see it happening in every so-called mundane situation that I enter into, there are people waiting. They're waiting everywhere for this news. And once they have to turn off the TV to find out about it, because it's being abused. It's abused as an instrument at this time. And on the contrary, the living beings that we are really the conduits of the message, you know, of hope, of transformation. And those of us who have either come to embrace Islam by the grace of God, since we didn't, it wasn't something that we had any choice about, and we were all born in this state, but our parents didn't know it, you know. So our process of coming to embrace this bounteous provision is that we shed the conditioning, the veils of conditioning, at a certain moment, and that message of the call from God, the call to prayer, came to us at different stages in our journey. I believe that most of us saw it in our dreams, and I know I did. You know, the message was coming in my dreams when I was a very small child, and then it started manifesting, it started speaking through the people that I met on my journey, and everything fit together to lead me to the point in Palestine when I, as a Jewish girl, having lived in Russian Orthodox monasteries and studied Buddhism and Vedanta and, you know, the path of love and the Sufi words circulating through my consciousness, came to understand that Islam was the completion of all that I had experienced in the most pure way, without any overlay of harshness. It was light upon light. It is light upon light. And it's light that leads to the light, and Allah leads to the light all the sincere seekers of light. And they would not be seeking the light unless Allah had willed it. Now, our understanding is, as we continue this journey, we may be walking in the mountains somewhere on this earth, or in a city somewhere, and someone, we cross paths with someone who is a seeker of light, right? And we have a backpack with food in it that others have given us. The sheikhs in my journey, every one of them, every one of the shuyukh, put into my backpack so much nourishment. I don't know what to do with it. I don't know how to distribute it, except that when I see someone who's hungry, I have to ask Allah, what do I have to give them? What has been given to me that it needs to be given to them? And it's the same for each of you. Many, many treasures have been imparted to your hearts and souls, and there are people that you will meet on the journey. Maybe it's going to be very cold one day, and someone, you have a coat. You may have the coat for that person. You have warmth. You have love The person is shaking from the coldness of isolation in this world, and you have the mantle that to bestow upon them. And you must do it. You cannot keep that mantle for yourself. It's not for you. I haven't read one word from this paper, so we'll just let it rest over there, okay? this is commonly the case. When I was in Jerusalem, I went to work on a book on Jerusalem called Jerusalem, A Garden in the Flames. And that message still resonates. That resonates because wherever on the earth, and Jerusalem is a major, major player in this worldly conflict, the garden must be watered. The garden, the seeds must be continued to be planted. Now, who can do that better than people like us, Jewish, Christian, Muslims, people who embrace all the truths, people who see the truth in all? We need to plant those seeds and cultivate them, not only in that land, but wherever we go. Wherever you start to see a conflict emerging between one tribe and another, you know, and we know, that we are people that are not tribally limited. That's why what Bawa said is so true. There's no black, there's no white, there's no yellow. And this community is a wonderful example. Everyone that I met so far has a heritage that comes from another land. And all those ancestors sent their progeny to this circle, including mine, my ancient rabbi grandfather, great-grandfathers. I have pictures of them reading the Torah. They were reading the Torah for me to come here to embrace Islam with all of you and carry the truths that were in the book they were reading. We cannot break apart this history of light, this divine history, which came down as revelation upon revelation. It came to all the peoples. And if they haven't heard it yet, it's our duty to tell them. Some people who are just listening to the news, they may not have heard what we heard. That's why any one of us, we should, you know, speak up in the media, but not, you know, but very humbly. And we don't want to go and fight a war with anyone, because that's exactly what we cannot do. We're not here to repel darkness with darkness. We're here to repel darkness with light. Now, in my experience, since I wrote a book and, you know, have been asked to speak in various places, including the media, I find that there are beautiful souls planted across the country, and actually they're just waiting. They're waiting for the news to be given, but others are not. You know, sometimes you may find the people are not ready. So I was saying with Sheikh Hamdi that we need to organize our group, our messages, you know, crystallize the crystals, bring together on the table of truths, crystals of mercy, crystals of wisdom, light, and that any person who is in any realm, they could be, have any job whatsoever, including being like a person who is, you know, the head of whatever is that Fox News. The head of Fox News might get it, you know, somewhere, somehow. Yes. So if we understand, and anyone can speak, I happen to be speaking right now, but the children can speak. The children must speak. You mentioned the name of someone. Who is that child that reminded you of Isa?
Eunice.
Eunice's graduation today. Eunice must speak. Eunice must speak. And, you know, in this way, somebody who's very connected to a lot of media people and came to my house the other day, I met her at some event. So she came over and she was just looking at the house. She was spellbound. You know, she's very interested in different countries. All the countries are in our house. You know, all that beauty of that grace is in our home. We can invite them over to sit at our Maidah and share the wonderful food. It's food in every way. And that way, they cannot say they didn't hear it. You know, because right now, if we don't do anything, you know, I happen to be right now, let's say, 60-something, almost 70, right? I don't know how long I have here, but if I don't make every single effort that I can before I leave this particular world to transmit this message, then I will not, it will not be clear that I did everything I could. It's not like we don't say that out of fear that we didn't do enough, but we say inspiring one another to do more, to figure out. And it doesn't, I don't only mean through media. It is in every way, and it starts at home. It starts at home in the middle of a conflict, an illusory, totally illusory conflict that you might be having with yourself. Let's start with oneself. So you're sitting there like having a conflict, and you hear the message that reminds you, Islam is peace. Where is the conflict coming from? And how can it be ended? How do we make peace with ourselves? How do we make peace with those with whom, in our family, and those in the job, you know? And it's only by diving deeper and deeper into the source of peace. And the source of peace, if you go towards it, is going to, like, that ocean is going to flow through you. It's going to flood you with grace. The mercy will flood you with grace if you just turn towards it. So we should shift our paradigm away from any other solution. The Quran itself is the solution as manifested through our comprehension, our experience, as is the zikr, through our comprehension of it as mercy, as love, and the understanding that the Quran is guidance for those who have taqwa is very important. And the understanding of taqwa is very important because it means so much more than it can is ever translated to be. You know, it cannot be fear, in my opinion. It is awe, wonder, comprehension, awareness of the infinite grace of God. So it's only in that state that we can learn to recite the Quran and receive what it has. And station by station, maqam by maqam, it will have more. That's why we can't just go to sleep and say, well, I think I know everything now. It's infinite. So I was going to read about the journey, but now I'm just going to talk about this journey. And the journey is where each one of us is at a certain mountaintop. We're at a certain place now. And, you know, we don't know what will happen tonight in our dreams. We don't know what mountains we have to climb yet. We don't know what will turn up tomorrow in our daily life that will be a challenge to our deen, a challenge to this, our celebration of praise. You know, you might have a test or two, and we do. Surely with difficulty comes ease. So you know it's that the difficulty has to come too, you know? And as friends on the journey, as beloved companions on this journey, support one another. And that's what your organization is for, supporting one another. That means that at any time, and I'm going to give you all my phone numbers so you can call me anytime, night or day, and say what's happening, you know, when you need that support. Even if you just say, I need support, you'll get it. That's what the Ummah is for. You say, I need support. Even in the monasteries where I lived, the nuns would put a little message to the person next door, I'm having this struggle with the devil or whoever you want to call it. Could you please pray for me? If they, you know, the way they did that was appropriate for them, and we have to do it for ourselves and with everyone who, so that no one feels isolated unless they need to be. There are moments called dark night of the soul. You have to go through them by yourself, and you never forget that you will get there. Never think that this is permanent. It's a passageway. And along the way, you learn the lessons that you need to help the next person coming along your path. You know, if you don't face traumas, you cannot heal traumas. You have to face your own traumas. And I wanted to encourage you to keep a journal. And it doesn't have to be on paper. But if you like, you can write it down. And this is a way of understanding your life story. I know that writing the book that I wrote was very, very incredibly helpful to me in fathom. First of all, almost everything negative passed away. I could not include it. It just passed away. So that's one value of writing the book. Let them, you say, I can't write about that, you know, but you can write another book about that, okay? I had a chapter, I'm not gonna tell you the title, but it was taken out of that book, but it still exists somewhere else, you know, so that I can understand what I went through then. So you say, on this journey, there are nights and days, there are darker nights, and then there are nights of light, many. There are many nights of light, you just can't even sleep, it's so bright. But after that, you might wake up and the morning is dark, you know, and you say, what happened? I had all of that understanding, where did it go? Well, you're going to another maqam. You're going to another maqam. It may look like a dark night, but it's not. It's a passageway into the next level of realization. Or you're on a dark night on a mountaintop, and you come to the most glorious horizon that you have ever seen. You have never seen anything like that. And that's the journey. So now, since we're fellow travelers, we have to support each other in that. There might be nights and days that no one knows what's happening to them. But as soon as we like sit together, two and three, and share that share the provision, share the grace that is, you know, one of us, and we call this spirituality of dialogue. I learned it from one of my sheikhs, Sheikh Ablai Jay taught a course called Spirituality of Dialogue. It means, as he explained it, every person has in their pocket what the other one needs. Now we have a community here, and each person is coming in with a wealth of things they have to give and a wealth of things they need. Who will have what you need? It will be the person that you're walking down the path with, or maybe the person that you meet tomorrow, you know, and you need to be open to receive and open, very open to give. And we'll see how this synergy works, you know, and how it has worked even today, how we got on the plane and somehow made it here, and everybody was cooperating beautifully to make everything happen. And the people came on the journey from Montreal, and I'm meeting people that I have waited years to meet. We are all joining together now. And who arranged this? Once again, I return back to the original point. There's no way on earth we could have arranged it. Even when we were sitting in the car driving to eat dinner last night, we shared information that was impossible for us to know that we had in common. We couldn't have ever been brought together on the face of the earth except that Allah said, it is time for these of my souls to come and share this knowledge that they've been holding separately, and now it's time to join together forevermore. You know, to carry this knowledge as a community. This is the model of the Ummah. It's the model of what the Ummah really is. And I want to complete this by saying that the way, Bismillahirrahmanirrahim, the way in which true Islam spread originally, the way that it spread to all the different countries that we come from, is not by the sword, but by love, mercy, compassion, and wisdom, and grace. So, if we are talking about da'wah, and we're not talking about it. Our hearts are filled with longing for the beautiful truths to be spread so that the people will be revived. The souls who are starving and hungry and fearful will be uplifted into this grace. Then we have to follow that sunnah of love and compassion and rightful conduct, right conduct, wise conduct. But if we make a mistake, we follow the example of asking for pardon, and we all do. We all do make mistakes. So forgive yourself quickly so that you can help forgive others and help embrace others. Don't waste too much time, but ask with all the sincerity of your heart just to be uplifted to the next maqam, so that you can be a vehicle of this transformation for everyone that you encounter, that as Allah has planned. And further to understand, when you write your journal, that Allah has decreed every drop of nourishment that you have received in your life. That's why your journal is important. Your story is important. Your life is important. Because everything that you have is a gift from the one who created you. And he gave it to you for a reason. He's been bestowing these gifts upon you throughout the ages. Finally, he says, now, take this bounty, this abundance of grace, and manifest it. And that's what we can all do together, and we are doing. And may Allah help us so, so much to do this. As we said, we can't do anything, and we have done nothing. But follow that mercy and beseech. We have beseeched his grace only because he guided us to do this. He guided us to be those of taqwa that truly implore his mercy and his guidance. And so I want to just end. I would like Sheikh Hamdi to make a dua, please, for the completion of this intention. And then we can talk some more about it.
الأبرار الأخيار برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين يا رب العالمين. اللهم يا حي يا قيوم يا مغيث يا منزل الغيث من السماء، أنت قدرت مجيء هذه السيدة الكريمة إلى بلادنا. يا حي يا قيوم يا رب العالمين، فهي ضيفة حلت عليك ونحن ضيوف عليها، ونحن كلنا ضيوف عند حضرتك يا أرحم الراحمين على بابك. لا تخيبنا يا حي يا قيوم، فقراءك على بابك، أيدينا ممدودة إلى كرمك وجودك يا أرحم الراحمين يا رب العالمين. لا تخيب منا أحدا ولا ترد منا واحدا، يا حي يا قيوم يا رب العالمين، اقبلنا وارحمنا واعف عنا يا كريم يا كريم يا كريم يا كريم. على ما نوته الشيخة مريم، وعلى ما نوته شيخة شهناز، وعلى ما نواه المشائخ الكرام، وعلى ما نواه الصالحون، وعلى ما نواه الصالحات، وعلى أشرف النيات، وعلى كل نية لله صالحة، وعلى ما نواه أستاذنا وأساتذتنا، وعلى ما نواه مشائخنا الكرام، وعلى كل نية صالحة ظهرت أو خفيت، يا حي يا قيوم يا رب العالمين. وإلى حضرة النبي محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم الفاتحة. آمين. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، الرحمن الرحيم، مالك يوم الدين، إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين، اهدنا الصراط المستقيم، صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين.
We'd love to have you come forth and ask questions or share from your experience. Does anyone have a question or a contribution? Mm-hmm. Yes, dear?
Does anyone want to share anything or? Sheikha Maryam, can I ask you a question?
Yes, please.
You were talking about sharing this grace and sharing this compassion, mm-hmm. And how that's our mission, and to follow the sunnah in that regard. What about, what should we do if we don't feel those things in our own heart?
The compassion?
The compassion towards our own selves or towards other people, or in the situations we find ourselves in, we feel frustrated, anxious, unhappy. What then?
That's a sign of Allah itself. It's a sign. When you see that you're in that state, it's a sign that you need to change that state. And you can. And if you go back over your journal, you know, how many times have you changed that state? Either you did it, or it was done for you. Right? Have we stayed in that state? Are you in that state now?
No.
I have not seen that you in that state. Where did that go, that time you were in that state? That was just like thrown along the way, like it's like the cocoon that is enveloping the butterfly. It went back into the earth. It's covering up something, and it's a process. In order to be able to help others heal trauma, you have to experience it. So when you look back, that's why I took out anything that I wrote in the book that was like negative, but I didn't take it out of my heart because it's a part of a teaching. And now look at yourself. It says, O physician, heal yourself. O physician, heal yourself. So we are healers of sorts, each and every one of us. And we have to understand, experiment. What does work for you? So I can tell you what works for me, and I'm sure it's the same thing that works for you, but I will say it again. First of all, it's the recognition, it's the furqan, it's the understanding that, like sometimes it strikes me, I who have been the recipient of all this grace, how can I exist in this state of doubt? What am I doubting? How can I doubt? How can I doubt that Allah will take care of this? So it's furqan to begin with. It's muraqabah, and then it's furqan, but along with that is always dua, and it's always salat, it's always recitation of Quran, it's always zikr, you know, and you say, well, I have to go from this place to this side of the chair, and what will take me there? Usually it doesn't take very long. It takes a paradigm shift in your heart and soul. You just shift your paradigm into the joy, into the peace, into the trust, tawakkul. So as Bawaz states it, it's sabur, so you have to have patience, shukur, gratitude no matter what, sabur, shukur, tawakkul, trust in Allah, alhamdulillah, back in alhamdulillah, we're home again. We're home again, alhamdulillah, there's no problem. There's no problem there. Okay, so that was one thing you're saying, I don't feel like it. Or you don't feel like you have the compassion for another. Let's say someone just bugs you. It really bugs you what they're doing. So then you have to dig a little deeper into your source of compassion within you, the source of compassion within you, like through dua. So I know I do a lot of zikr, invoking different qualities of God. You have to invoke the quality of God that you need. If it's mercy, go get it. It's waiting for you. The mercy is right there. It's that the kufr covers it up, or the whatever it is, this veil has covered up the fact that this is so near to you, it's closer to you than anything. You know? And even you, I can't even imagine you being in that state, but maybe once in a blue moon. And he could just tickle you and it'll be finished. Right? You're not really, but you're talking for everybody. You're talking for everybody, so it's a very valid point in the global sense. It's valid, because all of us fall off the horse once in a while, right? We sometimes just fall off, right? And the horse is just standing there, and you just gotta get back on and take a ride. Take a ride like we will, somebody might take a ride tomorrow. At least the horses will be there, you know? And so that's my understanding. And in your own self-analysis, you will see what works best for you when you're slightly disenchanted or you lose faith for maybe a split second. Let's not spend too long in that state, right? And then kind of go to the other person. They say, ew, right, I don't really believe that. We don't really believe it, you know, but still you have to sometimes, part of the process is digging deeper into your heart and accessing, and particularly when it's a conflict that is challenging to you specifically. Mm-hmm. So then you have to kind of make more effort to access this kind of current of grace that will come, I think.
Thank you.
Thank you. Since nobody likes to be first, I will be first so that the rest of you will follow.
Good job.
I have learned in my life that we have to be very careful what we ask Allah for, because He just may grant us that wish. For example, you may ask Allah for patience, and then Allah sends somebody your way that's going to test you in that. He's going to, like, somebody in your office, maybe everybody's perfect except for that one person that just annoys you, like, beyond anything. And that's because these qualities which the sister is talking about is not given to us, but we have to inculcate them into our lives through practice. So, again, we would ask Allah for forgiveness, to be a forgiving towards others, and then Allah will allow a person to come into our lives and do something to us that is going to be very difficult to forgive. They may wound you very deeply. They may steal from you. They may lie about you. They may slander you. And this is your test. And this is the time which you can either give into the hatred or give into the fear or give into the negativity, or you can begin to realize that this is Allah is giving you an opportunity. I want to also say one other thing. Is Allah does not need any of us. He does not even need our taqwa. I will tell you a short story of an incident that happened in Montreal of a man who was, we would consider to be a bad Muslim. He went to the bars and he drank alcohol. And we would look down upon him as being somebody who we would not want to associate with. So it was, and this is a true story, that this man happened to be black, and he also happened to be from another country, and the men at the bar begin to tease him and to taunt him about being black, about being a foreigner, about being different, and this man was not bothered by any of it. He just shrugged it off as nothing. But they began, when they realized that he was a Muslim, began to say bad things about the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. And he went ballistic. He literally grabbed these people and he punched them and he swore at them. And he said, how dare you say something like that against the Prophet Muhammad, alayhi salatu wasalam. Well, it just happened to be that there was a waitress that was observing all of this. And she scratched her head in bewilderment and said, how could it be that this man was tormented and teased and put down in every conceivable way, and he says nothing, but just as soon as they say something about Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, that he would go crazy. She became curious. She went to the mosque. Guess what happened? You know the rest of the story. She became Muslim, alhamdulillah, all because of this one man who we consider to be a bad Muslim that was kind of acting in a bad way and not really inculcating the qualities in which a good Muslim should exhibit in their lives. So we should always try to remain in a state of humility. And I remind myself first, of course, because I'm probably the worst among you when it comes to practice, but that Allah does not need us. Many people, I know at least 5 people have come to Islam at my hand, and I had absolutely nothing to do with it. They just came into my life, and I just happened to be there at that time. And so Allah does not need us, and we should always remember that, so that this will keep us in a state of humility. That's my contribution.
Thank you so much.
Alhamdulillah.
Thank you.
Thank you for the beautiful talk. So my question is something that is I relate to personally in terms of my own experience and my own journey. Having come to tasawwuf, I very much agree and I see the beauty of the message that you have brought forth, the message of hope, of beauty, of compassion and sharing love. And it is a message that is always a slow process. It's not a message that is, to share this message for it to spread and to bear fruits, it's a slow process. What answer would you have for the youth? And I'm speaking from personal experience, because I had this tendency myself before having come to the path of tasawwuf, who believe that Islam is in dire need of activism, and we need to take to the streets. Islam is in need of PR. Who look down upon people who just speak about love all the time and compassion all the time and you know, lovey-dovey and everything is fine and sharing and compassion. That message doesn't tend to resonate very well for segments of our youth. How do we as Muslims sort of respond to them, and what insights do you have to share on this point?
It's person to person. It's really dependent upon the group of people. I mean, I have worked with kids a lot and know lots of kids, and they're all different. You know, I don't know exactly the demographic of people that you're talking about, and each, of course, it depends entirely. I was watching something on television the other day, which was about that community in Palestine, which had a theater. There was a theater. It was terribly destroyed. I mean, really, it was just shattered, ultimately. But I saw it in its process, where there was a, you know, the activist for that theater is alive, but others are not. But he very greatly energized the youth of that community to manifest their belief, their faith, their themselves. So. I know for myself, let's say, and thank you very much for that, bringing that person into our circle as well, you know, and to understand everybody doing whatever they do is a contribution. In my case, I was very artistic and still basically artistic, but it was through the arts that I found my way. Painting, writing, sculpting, and then theater. So I have that orientation. So when I saw this thing about theater, I said, wow, that looks good to me. You know, it's engaging. You have to engage them. I'm not giving a talk to a bunch of kids about compassion right now, but I went to a mall. I was speaking at a mall in Philadelphia about a couple years ago, and we didn't know who would come, and suddenly it was filled with kids. And those kids were brilliant. And they were capable, and they were interested, and I talked to them. We just talked to them. You have to talk to the people, person by person, you know? Now, as for different activities, it depends on the people that you're talking to. What are their temperaments? We were talking today about that, about how, you know, teaching in school, right? We were talking about teaching in school and how the kids, it depends on what qualities are they manifesting, how to talk to them. You know, or what traumas are they? They may be traumatized at this point by being Muslim, even by being called Muslim. They said, we don't want to hear about that because of the news. So we want to enliven in them some beautiful way of manifestation that makes them feel proud, you know, as we are. We are proud, and let's see what we can do to make a difference or to express the beauty that we see, that we feel. You know, but it depends on the people, really. I'll go back to that again. You know, who are they? And if we could, I would like to meet them and see. There's always, I have friends who come and visit us who like to do Muslim rap and stuff like that. And I've been at peace conferences and Muslim gatherings where we were with a certain groups of people who are very, very well known for Muslim rap. And they were very nice people. So that's what they did. That's what they did. You know, it depends on the people. But I think young and old, it doesn't matter to me. You know, I mean, I integrate with everybody. I don't even see that. But it depends on cultural niches, you know, and the traumas that go with this different groups of people. What are they feeling? What are they going through? You know, and healing is needed. That's what we're talking about today. It's that what in this kind of dysfunctional culture that we live in, people are understandably, you know, pressured. And you see, we who have been on this journey for a while, we don't really have any doubts. You know, people can't really knock us down very easily because we've had too many signs of God that have just encouraged us, and we know that it doesn't matter what they say. Like the story of Mansour al-Halaj was just being described, peace and blessings be upon all the saints and awliya, and and how he responded to what happened to him. You know, you may have to give your life for it. Anything could happen to us by maintaining this, you know. But at this point, for us, we're going to do it because it's been revealed to us that we have to. Now, people, whoever they are, it doesn't have to be kids. It could be any age of person who's borderline. They're not sure, you know. And as you said, so I want to try to fully answer your question. So if you say just compassion and love, they may not like that. I don't know why, but they might have. What else should we say then? I mean, I'm not sure. Huh?
Talking about the university generation.
Okay. Okay.
I want to respond to it. People want to respond to the negative portrayal of Islam. And you feel that sitting down and just speaking compassion isn't enough.
Okay. Yeah, and my son is in working on his PhD, and I hear from him these ideas of, you know, even when we see the kind of, like, the certain kind of hypocrisy in religion, it makes us question. You know, when people say one thing and they do something else, it's very, very difficult for us. And so I think there's a new generation coming, which is, he speaks about it a lot, called critical thinking. And then it kind of, and I know I'm in a different state than he is, you know. I mean, I'm kind of like very much into the spirituality, and he is a critical thinker. And we talk a lot, day in and day out, until each person finds their niche. They have to find the place where it's authentic for them. You know, each person and each group of people, you know. But as I say, in each university, I mean, I went to classes with him. We went recently to his PhD class. It was very, very interesting to me. I really, really enjoyed it, you know. And I don't know if what age group anybody is, where they're at. And I think it's multi-dimensional, you know. And as I say, you, as a conscious instrument, have to answer your own question in a way, you know, because you know the people. You're dealing with it. Now you go deep into your own iman, your own knowledge, like your tools. What are the tools in your box? You know, in my case, it has to do with, I always go back to mercy because that's the strongest thing that I've ever felt in my life, you know? And it says, my mercy precedes my wrath, and I never took a step further than that. That was it. When I heard that, I said, that's fine with me. I can't deal with wrath very easily, so I said, I better stick with the mercy. And so that's why it's meaningful to me. But every person walking, every traveler on the path, you have to get your tools together, and then you see who you meet and how to help them go from one side to another. I'm going to give another example, because in that class that my son has been doing, it's called Conflict Resolution and Trauma Healing. And there was an example of, you know, we just saw many examples of people that were like highly traumatized, you know, and just about shattered, and how the process of trauma healing, of circle process, restorative justice, and things like this, there are patterns of community healing that work very well. It just depends on what the people actually need in that group. But also being buddies is good, making friends is good, you know, understanding what they do like, and then seeing how it works together. How can you make what they like work in proclaiming the goodness of the deen? If they want to. No compulsion.
Thank you.
Yes.
Assalamu alaikum.
Alaikum salam.
I wanted to ask for your thoughts on the idea of traveling. traveling, like, physically in the world, or being in one place. And maybe I can preface this question just sharing a little bit. I've had, you know, moments in my life where I've really had to physically relocate somewhere to find a, you know, to see myself afresh. kind of thing, like all my mirrors were foggy here and I had to go somewhere else to be able to, oh, really, that's how I am? That's me, right? And then there's also been times where I thought, oh, I need to go abroad to really, you know, in the mountain and find my teacher, and actually it was in my own bedroom where I had to just like be still, you know? And I think a lot of us have this desire to, you know, hit the open road, so to speak, and just let God be the driver and come what may. And at the same time, there's part of that is like our own idealizing the trip and our own, you know, kind of, hey, here's a picture of me in front of some cool maqam, and this is a picture of me on a mountain. And you know, there's like a lot of just ego trip in it too. And so maybe how can we navigate that and to really, you know when it's sincerely traveling for the sake of Allah and when it's really just time to sit still. And even if it feels like we're just in some kind of daily grind and maybe that's really where we're meant to be and not, you know, off. Yeah, I guess that's my question.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. We go back to taqwa, as we define it, living in the presence of the divine, living in the presence of the beloved. Whether we go or we do not go is not up to us. And I say that from my own experience. I mean, I've been just taken around the whole world and I never knew where I was going. I never followed a map. I had no idea. Even here, I didn't choose this. I didn't make this plan. That's what I said to begin with, that when you are in that state of awareness that Allah has decreed it, it's already decreed. It's written. I believe, I mean, we discuss, is there free will or there's no free will? This is one of the discussions we have. But I'm not even thinking like that. I feel that, first of all, everything you said is true. Like when you go into your own room, everything is there. The whole universe is there. When you make a halwa, for example, or some spiritual retreat, everything is there. There's nowhere to go. There's nowhere to go better than just being where you are. When you're on a journey, you have to be where you are, you know? But the traveling fi sabilillah is a very profound activity from my point of view, you know, including coming here. I mean, could I have done this by sitting in my room? I could not have met you sitting in my room unless I dreamt about it, all of you, you know? And sometimes we go to a place out in the middle of who knows where, and I meet one person, and I had to meet that person there. But it's not to take a picture in a beautiful, it's not for the ego. It's not about the ego at all. It's about the journey to God, everything. You know, whether you go in or you go out, you're going on a journey to God. And that's all there is. That's all there is. But as for, I think in the time when I traveled, it was easier to travel, you know, but some people got into trouble even then, you know, and I know I was protected. But at this time, it may be more challenging in some ways and yet necessary. If anybody asked me to go anywhere in the world, I would go. If Allah had intended it, you know, I mean, not just anybody, but if that power of God was saying, go there, it wouldn't matter if there was a war going on. And there were. I entered places where wars were going on, you know, smaller ones. But that's not my advice. My advice is not to just go into a war zone. My advice is to follow the guide. Be, you know, immerse yourself in that presence of the divine guide. And that's it. That's it. You go in and you go out. And everywhere you go, there it is. It's with you. So I think that's it, you know, and each one has a different destiny, and even at different times of your life, sometimes you travel more externally. What you said is very valid. You may have to leave a certain place in order to discover something about yourself. You may come back to the same place and be completely transformed. You may go into a halwa in one state and come out completely different, you know, and on the other hand, there's the continuity of the journey, step by step. Step by step, you come to greater realizations. There's not even a big thing to think about. You're just on the journey, right? And then, like, every day, It's a daily practice of discovery, of getting closer. And then you see some days you find that there's a barrier there. Seriously, there are some serious barriers you have to penetrate. This is not easy. So you then the question that you asked is perfectly valid. What do we do then? You're going along, everything, it's like a beautiful, beautiful sunny day on the journey, and suddenly there's a huge storm, you don't have any protection, and you're out there in the middle of it. And then you need faith, you need tawakkul, you need, you know, like you have to remind yourself, and I do at those moments, how many blessings have descended upon me, and they are descending upon me now. This is a test, and on the other side will come greater knowledge, but even in the middle of it, because it says with the difficulty comes the ease. So what I suggest is, at those moments when you just, any kind of difficulty is happening, remember that, and that's why I personally, and probably many of us, I say that Aya more than any, to keep me in awareness that there's something so close to that difficulty that is going to be, you know, a transcendent aid to me, to bring me actually to right out of the difficulty, until I get to the next one.
We have time for just one more question.
And more tomorrow. We can just go on sharing. Alaikum salam.
A lot of people in our community who serve and work kind of on the front lines of our community, they talk about not getting tired because of their sincerity. They talk about serving and serving, and if it's for Allah, then it's Allah will make it easy. So what advice can you give us about service and how to be with people and do it sincerely so it's not draining or difficult?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It goes along with the last question, because there's an inner dimension and an outer dimension, or several different dimensions of the word ibadah. Ibadah is service, worship, surrender, praise. You know, ibadah is all that. It's a lot of different, it has an inner and an outer, many inner and outer dimensions. So if you just go into the front lines day after day, you know, and serve and serve and serve, but you don't go inside and worship and love, you know, and praise, then you will become unbalanced. You could become unbalanced because the world is demanding and you're not getting your restoration. And so I'm always fascinated by the word ibadah and what it contains in it, you know. So we have to have enough inner time to regenerate, to, you know, you have to go back to the source to get the strength you need to transform this world. And then, you know, you go, so you go out there and then you come back, right? And along the way, find your own tools. Once again, you have your own toolbox. So when you're doing that kind of work, and I really pray, you know, celebrate that you're doing it. It's super great that you're doing it. So one thing to do is remember that. You know, encourage yourself. If it gets hard, say, this is great that I'm doing this. I'm doing something to serve other lives. I'm doing something to manifest the deen. And like the story that we heard, you know, in the middle of what you're doing, people's other lives will be transformed. You know, you're just doing this duty for the sake of goodness and for the sake of God, but other people do see it, and it can transform their lives. And that's how the life goes on, regenerating that purity, that wisdom, the possibilities of dawah. It's a dawah that you're doing. Dawah is manifesting it. And a lot of times you just hear about Christians going and doing charity. It's not as often that we hear that about Muslims, and we need to see this. This needs to happen. So it's wonderful you're on the front lines doing it, you know? And just keep praying while you're doing it. Keep making your zikr. Make your zikr. See that beauty inherent in those beings, even when they're acting a little strange. And then a miracle can take place at any moment. And then don't forget that. You see, right in the moment of that hardcore difficulty, somebody was greatly benefited by your effort. And that needs to sustain you, you know, and make you feel like going back again. And some days you don't feel like that, you know. So just don't forget the miracles and know that they're coming. They will continue to manifest.
Thank you so much, Sheikha Maryam.
answer for Sister Adel's question is actually the key word is ibadah. The verse in Surah Al-Furqan, you're talking about Furqan? Surah Al-Furqan, verse 61 and following. At some point, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, وَعِبَادُ الرَّحْمَنِ الَّذِينَ يَمْشُونَ عَلَى الْأَرْضِ هَوْنَا وَإِذَا خَطَبَهُمُ الْجَاهِلُونَ قَالُوا سَلَامًا وَالَّذِينَ يَبِيتُونَ لِرَبِّهِمْ سُجَدًا وَقِيَامًا. Since the beginning, the description is going like the two things, the inner and the outer dimension. وَعِبَادُ الرَّحْمَنِ. So to make ibadah, we think always like ibadah is an action. But ibadah is actually to be abd, to be all those dimensions. So both, two things. They are يَمْشُونَ عَلَى الْأَرْضِ, they are serving. They are walking on earth. But when they are serving, Allahu Akbar, they're doing it with a humility. They are doing it with a humility. Naam. Alhamdulillah. Naam. Okay. Alhamdulillah. So Ibadur Rahman, they walk on earth when they serve, so they do that serving so they don't feel drained. They have to be hauna, they have to be gentle with people. And I can tell you from my own experience what eats in your I'm not telling you that I serve all, but what eats from your energy, what drains you really when you tend to be harsh on people. That comes back on you that very night, and that really you get beaten up. So if you want to walk on the earth, if you want to be outside, you really need to be gentle. And the name is of the qualities of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sheikh Abdullah al-Haddad, inshallah, we are going to meet him tomorrow. He gave me four qualities. He told me just, say, Ya Halim, Ya Sabur, Ya Kareem, Ya Wadud. These are like Halim, forbearant, patient, generous, and showing love and compassion. So if you want to serve, you have to have these four qualities. And وَإِذَا خَطَبَهَمُ الْجَاهِلُونَ قَالُوا سَلَامًا. This is forbearance. While serving, you will find jahileen all the time. You will find jahiloon around you. You will find ignorant people around you. It's not because they are ignorant, but they are not acknowledging you. So jahiluna here can mean, and if people who are not acknowledging what you are doing or who you feel you are, etc., just say salama. And then the inner dimension, وَالَّذِينَ يَبِيتُونَ لِرَبِّهِمْ سُجَدًا وَقِيَامًا. So during the night, during the day, they are walking on earth and serving, and then during the night, they have to have that يَبِيتُونَ رَبِّهِمْ سُجَدًا وَقِيَامًا. And in Quran, too, we have the answer. There are two surahs starting with قُمْ, stand up. The first one is قُمُ اللَّيْلَ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا, stand up during the night. And after that is قُمْ فَأَنذِرْ. After that is stand up and walk and call people towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. SubhanAllah, maybe this is... thank you for the word, redefining the word ibadah for me and for everyone. Thank you very much.
Alhamdulillah. Thank you. Thank you, Sheikha Maryam. Maybe if you could make a dua for all of us,
I would like to begin by thanking everyone and embracing everyone and praying for everyone. Praying for us all. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone knows Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Ar Rahmanir Rahim. Maliki Yawmiddin. Iyaka na'budu wa iyaka nasta'in. Edina siratal mustaqim, siratal ladina anamta alayhim, ghayril maktubi alayhim, waladolin. Amin. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Wal asr. Inna linsana lafi husr. Illa ladhina amanu wa amilu salihati wa tawassaw bil haqqi wa tawassaw bis sabr. O Allah, you have assembled us in your presence. You have created us by your love and for your own deep purpose. Please enlighten us, guide us, make us amongst those you lead to your light. Day in and day out, make us understand the purpose for which you created us, that our lives will not be in vain. Let us advise each other in truth. Let us advise each other to be patient. Let us embrace each other on the journey. Let us turn to you in every situation. Let us become the vessels of your grace. Let us be transformed in your presence. We beseech thine aid in every matter. We pray for all the people across the face of this universe. The people who are suffering right now in dire circumstances. We ask that your grace shine upon them, pour down upon them. We ask for the people who are in the trials of the struggle of death at this moment, that the Muslims, the believers, the people of faith, the true seekers, that your presence envelop them and that they be freed of their sins. And we ask that we aid one another in this journey so that we will all arrive in your presence now and forever, pleased and well-pleasing to you. Please be our dearest and greatest companion in every on every day of our life. Let us abide in your presence. Let us do good for the sake of good. Serve you in everything, in every way that is possible. Amin, amin. Ya Rabbil Alameen. Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammadin, Nabi al-Lumi wa ala alihi wa sabihi wa salam. Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammadin, Nabi al-Lumi wa ala alihi wa sabihi wa salam. Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammadin, Nabi al-Lumi wa ala alihi wa sabihi wa salam tasliman. Subhana rabbika rabbil azati amma yasifun wa salamun alal mursaleen walhamdu lillahi rabbil alameen. Amin, amin, ya rabbil
in darkness sat a glorious light. God's prophet now to them hath come Muhammad al-Amin. Rabbi salli ala nabi shafi. Fell before the sword of God. Rabbi salli ala nabi shafi'ina Ahmad. Allah salli Rabbi ala nabi maulana Muhammad. To bless our Arabia and the world, most surely thou wast raised. We'll sing thy praises evermore, Mustafa the praise. Rabbi salli ala nabi shafi'ina Ahmad. Salli Rabbi ala Nabi Mawlana Muhammad. We watch with gentle fostering care the seed that thou hast sown, and trust to hear the world declare God's prophet as its own. Rabbi salli ala nabi shafi'ina Ahmad. Allah salli Rabbi ala nabi maulana Muhammad. Rabbi salli ala nabi shafi'ina Ahmad. Salli Rabbi ala nabi maulana Muhammad. Allahumma salli wa sallim wa barik alayhi wa ala alihi.
Thank you so much, all of you. Love you too. Thank you, Sheikha Maryam. Barakallah fikum. If anyone wants to come and greet Sheikha Maryam, it's your opportunity. And inshallah, I think we're going to pray here. Maghrib, if anyone needs to leave, please come and greet Sheikha Maryam before you leave and welcome her once again to Ottawa. Thank you so much.